So a little bit different. We had a change in plans today, or a change in that I didn't know about until about 5 minutes ago. So just let us change. Let's have worship team come up, and we'll continue worship. And this next song is one of my favorite Christmas hymns, "O Come All Ye Faithful." So everybody should know that it's one of the staples. O come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant, O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. In Christ the Lord. Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing, all ye bright hosts of heaven above. Glory to God all, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Worthy, you are worthy, King of kings, Lord of lords, you are worthy. Worthy, you are worthy, King of kings, Lord of lords, I worship you.
Holy now.
Holy, you are holy, King of kings, Lord of lords, you are holy. Holy, you are holy, King of kings, Lord of lords, I worship you. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory give. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Come, thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our fears and sins release us, God, us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of
righteous kingdom bring. Ruling of eternal spirit, ruling all our hearts alone, by thine all-sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne. Raise us to thy glorious throne.
Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. I'm going to stay down here. Does that work for you? All right. Well, it's been a long time since I've stood up and done the announcements. I probably don't know what I'm doing anymore. One thing is we don't have bulletins today. I haven't seen any bulletins, so you'll have to take notes. I'm going to try and read my way through what I see up there. On Monday is our food pantry. It starts at 10 a.m. Do we have a delivery? Do we need a unloading? Who knows the answer to that? So people to unload at 8:30 here at the church, and then the pantry is at 10. Yes, ma'am? All right, thank you. So on Monday is the ladies' Christmas get-together at, I can't read it, 5:30, thank you, at Michelle's, I believe. And I know you're looking forward to that. That'll be a good time. On Wednesday, we have Praise and Praise, which we sing the hymns. Is that what we're planning? We haven't called it that in a long time. New Generation, Team Kids, 7 to 8 p.m. come Wednesday night. On December 11th, that's the New Generation Youth Group Christmas Party, 4:30 to 10, and a breakfast on the 12th. What is that going to be? Is that like an all-night party, or is that a lock-in? No? Yeah, that's the youth group. Of youth and youth, you'll figure it out, won't you? December 18th, men's Christmas movie and chili. Oh boy. 5 to 8. Okay, so far so good. Not through that. Although we don't have bulletins, we do have a couple of inserts that were meant to go in the bulletins, and you can pick those up from the ushers or in the back of the sanctuary. And there are some things in here about the kids' ministry. On Sunday, December 19th, the kids will be having their Christmas party from 10 to 2:30. We're going to have games, crafts, movie, and pizza. Let Nan or Lori know if your child is going to be there so they know how much pizza to get. And there is a flyer about the Christmas Missions Project, which, again, they're going to buy livestock to bless a family somewhere overseas. And their goal this year is $215 for one goat, two ducks, three rabbits, and four chickens. No partridge, no pear tree. So encourage your children, if you have children in that group, to bring their offerings on Wednesday nights. And adults, if you would like to help them reach their goal, that would be very much appreciated. And there are two other things that I was told. It isn't even on here, so maybe we already know that. But Dorothy told me that she plans to postpone the Moms with Kids in Heaven for this month. I think that was meant to be next week. And so check with her if you're in doubt about that. And Jackie asked me, on behalf of the card ministry, if you haven't gotten a card from the card ministry yet and you would like to blessed in that way, let her know. They don't know every name, and they have trouble sometimes remembering all the names. ladies that they would like to send cards to, but they seem to have plenty of cards and plenty of card writers. So don't hesitate to ask or to recommend someone else if you'd like to the card ministry. Is that all right, Jackie? Yeah, there you go. So go ahead and be proactive. I know when I get one, I'm blessed by it, and I appreciate it. I think that's all I've got going on here. So I'm going to ask the ushers if they'll come down for the offering. Father, thank you so much for these that are here this morning to worship and those who are watching on the internet. Lord, we pray that you will be with those who are still sick and still away. It's a blessing to see Justin and Almeida and Angela back. Glad to see them. We pray for each one that's out there that's sick and that cannot be with us this morning. Thank you for this offering that we're taking up, Lord. Help us to spend it wisely and use it for your glory. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name.
Fellowship and kind of greet each other and as we prepare for the message.
All right, if everybody head back to their seats. No way. All right, it's Advent season once again here at the Cobb. And last week, Jerry preached on hope. And this week's sermon is going to be on love. So I'm going to do the candles, and then we'll get started here. All right, I'm going to be reading out of 1 John chapter 3, verses 11 to 18. If you want to follow along in your Bibles, your Bible apps, or whatever, you're more than welcome. This is the message you heard from the beginning. We should love one another. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brothers were righteous. Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love our brothers. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life in him. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need, but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions in truth. All right, when it comes to loving God, if we don't love others, we're not doing as God has commanded. We don't just say we love, we live it out faithfully and authentically. I have a little love letter here from a woman who's writing to her ex-husband. And it says, "No words could ever express the great unhappiness I have felt since our divorce. Please say you will take me back. You have always been my first and only love. I love you. I love you. I love you. Yours forever, Candy. P.S. Congratulations on winning the state lottery." True love has no meaning, it has no motive, but love is selflessness. Love others no matter what they have done to you. Thomas Kempis once said, "Whoever loves much does much." That statement agrees with the concept we are looking at in today's word. Let's start with verse 11 from your reading in 1 John. "For this is the message you heard from the beginning. We should love one another." Let's go back to the Gospel of John where it states, "For God so loved the world." I'll say it again. "For God so loved the world. He gave us his Son as our salvation." That is the message of love. Our natural Christian response should be to share that love with others. Love proclaimed results in love displayed. So because God first loved us, then we only have two things to do in response is love God and love others. We go on to verse 12. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brother's were righteous. We know that because God was pleased with Abel's sacrifice, and Cain was angry and jealous of his brother to the point that he killed Abel. As a result, Cain could no longer be a farmer. He was sent out to be a wanderer, and his descendants would end up prosperous, but yet worldly and totally without God. Cain's legacy led to destruction that was brought on by the flood. To live like Cain is to plant seeds of jealousy that grows and bears fruit of hatred. When you live like Abel, don't be surprised when you have a Cain in your life that hates you. Verse 13. Do not be surprised, my brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. What John is trying to tell us here is even though Abel did what was right, he was hated for it. Jesus told all of us, the world will hate you, but remember, it hated me first. Loving someone doesn't mean automatic love in return. Look at how the world has rejected Jesus. Should we stop loving then? No, sir. No. We need to love all the more. It's natural to love when it's returned, but it's supernatural to love those who hate us. Verse 14. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Anyone who does not love remains in death. The phrase to pass from death to life is spoken in the perfect past tense. What that means is it has already happened and we are living it now. A clearer explanation is if you have already been saved, you have already passed from death to life, and you're living that life now. Our transformation has already happened. We have already been given life, not later, but now. The word because here in verse 14 refers to the assurance with our new life that we can have love for each other. If we are honest, that's the word, if we're honest, people can be hard to love. Again, an amen on that one? It can only be God's work in us that enables us to love others. Truth is, without Christ, we will always be embittered toward those who don't do things our way. We should not be quick to get angry at others for being different. We can't even get ourselves to act the way that we want. God has forgiven us and still loves us in spite of what we do. We should do the same. In Christ, we are a new creation. So whether it is loving our spouse or a friend who annoys us or an enemy who hates us, we love because we have been so deeply loved. Scripture says that if your heart is not right, then you are no better off than a murderer. Remember Cain? Perfect example. We'll go on to verse 15. Anyone who hates a brother or sister is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life. We may not physically murder someone, but hate breaks that command that Jesus gave about loving one another. We may never think of taking someone's life, but hate is still just as severe. Why? Why, you ask? Because love and hate are moral opposites. I am in a relationship with God who is love, yet I hate. That's a break in our fellowship with God. Now, when we break fellowship, we need to repent and be welcomed back. When planting seeds of love, we will bear fruit of life. The only way this is possible is through Christ, who showed us love first. Verse 16. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Christ's death was the means by which God proclaimed his love for us. Laid down his life only appears in the New Testament. Jesus didn't die from martyrdom. He died out of his own selflessness to give us what we could not get ourselves. Clearly, laying down your life for someone is extremely difficult. I mean, even if it's a loved one. But what of a stranger or even an enemy? As Christians, we should be selfless. Live like Christ. It is doubtful we will ever be required to do the heroic deed of dying for someone. But we can show it in so many other ways. In fact, here's one. We're going to celebrate communion this morning. 1 Corinthians 11, with 23 through 29, tells us what happened that night. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on that night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant. In my blood, do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself." Now, if everyone would bow your heads and seek forgiveness for whatever sins are in your life, and I will close in prayer in a minute here. Lord Jesus, we bow before you in humility and ask that you examine our hearts. Show us any pride, unconfessed sin, stubbornness, rebellion, or unforgiveness that is in our lives. We know we are your beloved children. We know the price you paid to make us yours. And it is our desire to live for you. In your precious name, amen. The ushers will come down. And on that night, Jesus took the bread and broke it and gave to each one and said, "Eat, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." Also on that night, he took the cup and said, "This is a covenant between me and thee. Do this also in remembrance of me." Verses 17 and 18, we'll finish up here together. And they say, if anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. John concludes these two verses for us by showing our love as one of self-sacrifice. Two reasons we are Christians, and as a family here at God, at Cobb, we claim to love the whole world, but we seem to allow exceptions. Loving the world means we do not disdain anyone, not our neighbors, parents, people who hate us, and unfortunately, this is my downfall, idiots on the road. Peggy is always after me about that one. And those are just to name a few. It is a command to keep fellowship with God by keeping peace with others. Love for others is not wasted if it is given selflessly. It will flow forth, soften a bitter heart, both your or my heart and the person we are loving. Love is more than lip service. It is a way of life. Listen to this story that will illustrate my point. Two men in the same hospital room, both lying flat on their backs. One man is allowed to sit up in his bed for an hour every day to help drain the fluid from his lungs. His bed is right next to the only window in the room. The other man had to spend all of his time flat on his back. The two men would talk for hours on end on things like family, their homes, jobs, vacations they took. Every afternoon, when the guy by the window would sit up, he would look out the window and describe what he saw outside. The man who was flat on his back began to look forward to that 1 hour. People, cars, activities. The park across the street were a few of the items described. There was a lake in the park with ducks and geese swimming, with little kids fishing, while others played in the water. And there were still other things going on. There were trees and flowers and a city just past the lake. All of this was described. The other man would sit with his eyes closed and live through his roommate's picturesque scenery. One day, as he was describing a parade passing by, his roommate had an odd thought. Why does he get to see all that and me nothing? It wasn't fair. He felt bad about it at first, but as days went by, those feelings left. One night, he heard the other fellow gasping and gurgling, but never did anything about it. Never pushed his call button for the nurse. In the morning, the nurse came in to check on them and found the man by the window dead. After a few days, the other man asked if he could be moved over to the window. His bed was moved, and after the staff had left, he slowly and painfully lifted himself up and looked out the window, only to see a blank wall. King of glory, thank you for revealing your love to us. Today, in a powerful way, as we leave this place and go out there, may we go in the power of the Holy Spirit. May your grace and love be with us each day. Bless us, O Lord, with your unfailing love, and cause the work of our hands to prosper. Uphold us in the palm of your hand and see us through each stage of our lives. Bless us when we go out and when we come in. In Jesus' name we believe and pray. Amen.
This is the day that changed history, that Christ our Lord was born to us. Let us rejoice, let us be glad that God is here, Emmanuel. This is the day that changed history, that Christ our Lord was born to us. Let us rejoice, let us be glad that God is here, Emmanuel. Emmanuel has come to us. Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, God's gift to us. For he is here, he's come to say, Emmanuel. He is the one that was prophesied. He is God's gift for all mankind. The gift of love, the gift of hope. We thank you, God, for Christ our Lord. Emmanuel has come to us. Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, God's gift to us. For he is here, he's come to save. Emmanuel has come to us. Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel, God's gift to us. For he is here, he's come to say, Emmanuel. For he is here, he's come to say, Emmanuel.
Before we do the benediction, Roger has a announcement or two that he'd forgot earlier.
You know, I told you that it's been a long time since I've done announcements, and I probably didn't remember how. I forgot the first rule for announcement givers, which is anything you want to remember to say, you will write it down. Otherwise, you will forget it. And I forgot to tell you about the little Christmas tree that is on the table back there. That represents our mission project for Christmas time. It represents Akron Pregnancy Services. We've done for several years, we've put tags on there that represent things that they could use to give to the children or the parents that they serve at Akron Pregnancy Services, crisis pregnancy families. So there are a bunch of tags back there. You can go back and pick one or more than one, or share one with somebody else, whatever you'd like to do. There are two types of tags this year, at least on our tree. One is for a box of Pampers of this size or that size. how big of a box, the biggest one you would like to give. And the rest are for outfits of various sizes, either for a boy or for a girl. Now, Christmas is getting close. Not everything that they receive through these will go at Christmas. If they have leftovers, they'll put them in stock and give them away when the time is appropriate. So not everyone has to be back by Christmas. But they would like to have them down there by the 17th. That's a week from Friday. That means if you would like to do a tag, please get a tag today and do it. And bring it back next Sunday. And we'll collect them. I'll take them down. But if they come in later, that's okay. Don't say, oops, I forgot. Too bad. No, get it anyway. They can use it sooner or later. And I appreciate your indulgence of my carelessness, and I will appreciate your support for Akron Pregnancy Services. And Merry Christmas.
All right, our benediction this morning is found in the book of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 37 to 39. Jesus replied, "Love your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself." So let's go out there and love our neighbors.